So what we're going to do is we're here to expose it, let people tell their story, and let everybody in the public see the horrors of the court system in Suffolk County, New York.
Long Island Backstory with Chief Correspondent Gary Jacobs.
Good afternoon, I'm Gary Jacobs, and welcome to Long Island Backstory, where we're filming at the Cablevision Studios in Hopog, New York. You may notice that I'm talking really fast today because I'm really excited about my next guest, and I have a lot of stuff to ask him about, so I'm going to use my Long Island speed and talk as fast as I can so I can get as many questions in as possible. My next guest is Larry Sharpe, who's running against Governor Cuomo in the state of New York for governor, and this is something that really, really needs to be done because big problem here in New York, and I did a lot of research on my next guest and his guy, and I've never voted for a libertarian in my life, but when I read about this guy, really, we have a lot of things in common. So my guest is Larry Sharpe. Let me just read a little bit about him, and then we're going to get right into the questions. Larry Sharpe is a libertarian candidate for governor of New York running against Andrew Cuomo. Larry's a Bronx native, a Marine Corps veteran, an entrepreneur, and management consultant with 15 years experience mentoring international executives, entrepreneurs, and salespeople. He's also a teacher, previously serving as guest instructor for business management and leadership at institutions such as Yale University, Columbia University, Baruch College, John Jay College, and he is now running for governor in our lovely state of New York to make education more affordable and effective through innovation, reform the criminal justice system, and focus on rehabilitation and build the economy that works for New York State. So Larry, welcome to Long Island Backstory.
I am happy to be back out here. I went to high school in Long Island.
Oh, did you? Where'd you go?
I went to Central Islip High School.
Oh,
graduated
okay.
In 1985, 86.
Unfortunately, I spent a lot of time in Central Islip because that's where the court system is.
So that's a good and bad thing. Yes.
Unfortunately.
Yes.
So when you came out here today, you kept emailing me that you were running late, you were in a lot of traffic, and when you sat down, the first thing I said to you was, well, Larry, do something about the traffic. And you said, funny you mentioned that. So that's going to be my first question is, what are we going to do about the traffic? Because it sucks and it's driving us crazy.
And the worst part is it actually should be embarrassing, and it's not. We've come almost an idea of learned helplessness. We've accepted how bad things are.
It's true.
And we just joke about it. Yes,
we
joke about it, yes. And this is a symptom. I mean, if you look at what's happening, about 70% of New Yorkers don't vote anymore. 70% don't vote. That means that of about 18, 19 million New Yorkers, about 12 million are eligible to vote, only about 4 million are going to vote. That means about 8 million people who've just given up.
Right.
With that in mind, about 100,000 New Yorkers leave our state every single year.
100,000.
Over 100,000. Every single year. They're flooding away from our state. And one of the reasons, there are many of them, but one of them is transportation. Right? If you go upstate, you have problems. Western New York, Central New York, upstate New York, Northern Country, you have trouble with how to get around in general. You come downstate, it's the MTA.
Right.
It's a disaster. The MTA is the perfect example of what Cuomo does very well, and that is create some kind of entity that's supposed to fix things. It's kind of private, but kind of public, but the worst part is no one's in charge. So what does he do? He begins to appoint people. Well, what a coincidence, about $800,000 comes from appointees into his campaign funds. So he's able to do that so he can basically reward those people who are loyal to him. It is literally a petri dish. Yes, it's a petri dish for corruption. But here's the best part about it. Since these things are separate entities, he can say, oh, I'm not responsible. I don't know. I'm not responsible. And he can lament for the past 7 years about how things are bad, even though he's in charge. But on top of that, that's why everyone else around them goes to jail, but not him. Because those are his way of protecting himself from that. He's very good at it. Now, why does that affect us? Because the MTA is a disaster. The average MTA employee gets about $118 per hour.
What?
Yes, and the average New Yorker makes about 20 some odd dollars per hour. The average New York City worker who tends to have higher salaries makes a little over $30 per hour.
Wow.
So they make four times as much money. But not just that. There are a bunch of taxes now that go from outside. Tolls on bridges now pay for the MTA. Property taxes, parts of payroll tax. They start paying for the MTA. They begin to pick and choose and put more money towards the MTA. So now our job is to put more money into the MTA. Now we want to actually make Lyft and taxi drivers, now they have to pay for the MTA. So the answer is they make $118 per hour, and our answer is give them more money to fix them. No, the answer is no more money to the MTA. It has its budget. Fix it with what you got. If that doesn't work, too bad. That's all you get. When that becomes the rule, that's all you get and no more, you will see things have to change. Don't get me wrong, there will be disruption before that happens. But there's disruption now. New sure. York City right now goes from New York City and then it rains and it's Mogadishu. Overnight, it's Mogadishu. Yep. It took me an hour to get from Manhattan to Queens today in the subway. It's the subway, it's probably 7 miles. It took a half an hour. To come from my place where I live in Astoria, Queens, here is about 40 miles. It took me 2.5 hours. We are already failing everywhere.
Can't do much worse.
We're already failing. So my answer is no more money. Tell them, fix it the way it is. If they get mad and get pissed off, and so what? It's already a disaster.
Where are you going to go get a job? They're not going to quit. I can guarantee you.
Let them.
If,
I don't mind.
If you cut their pay from $113 an hour to $60 an hour, they're going to still stay there.
I'm not going to cut anything. Uh-huh. That's the point. The MTA will do what it must do to fix itself. I'm not cutting anything. But what I will do on top of that is two more things. The first one is I will be open to raising money other ways. One of the ways I want to raise money is things like I want to put naming rights on bridges. Right now, we are actually doing things like naming the Tappan Zee Bridge over our imperial family, the Cuomos. The Mario Cuomo Bridge. Now, the imperial family has a bridge. I can't believe we have that. It's embarrassing.
Somebody would have paid a lot of money for that.
That is correct. Now, this is not crazy because if you look right now, you have people spending tens of millions of dollars per year to have a stadium with their name on it, and it's used half a year. What if all of a sudden that wasn't a bridge? The MTA itself has over a dozen bridges just in New York City. If all of a sudden now someone was able to say, put your name on a bridge, and that name now gets mentioned literally hundreds of times on the radio and TV every single morning during rush hour and every single afternoon during rush hour, and it's a 16 million metro area, they wouldn't pay $50, $100 million for that.
Right.
Multiply that by 12, now we're literally raising billions of dollars without one extra taxpayer dollar at all. Third part to this, and that is be open to any other idea that anybody wants to move into New York City. I don't care if it's VIA, which is the cars that go around like buses, whether it's a Google road that goes up and down Broadway, whether it's getting rid of bike lanes or increasing bike lanes, whether it's helicopters or drones. These are all ideas people are talking about. Hey, guess what? I'm happy. Bring it to New York City. Bring it to New York City and let's start making some changes. I'm okay with that.
That's great. Well, I'm going to move on, but that's something that's bothered me is I travel all over the world. Mm-hmm. And usually public transportation is something that we encourage people to do because you want to keep cars off the road.
Absolutely.
On Long Island, the Long Island Railroad is so expensive.
Yes.
I look at it and I say, you know what, I'd love to sit on the train and not have to deal with it. But to tell you the truth, if I'm going in with three people, it's going to cost me $65.
Yes.
It's cheaper for me to drive in and I'm sitting in my car in traffic, but I do it. So we need to make it cheaper to take the train,
but
and that would take
problem.
Cars off the road.
The problem is the MTA's customer isn't us. The MTA's customer is the government. They're the ones paying them. We're not actually paying them. Our fees, taxes help to pay all the pensions. There are people who have literally been retired for 10, 15 years who make $300,000 a year in pension. I'm not making that up. Do your own homework. That's true. Right? So this is accurate. This is what's happening. It is a broken,
for a
corrupt
broken system, too.
System. Yes. And we get crappy service.
Right.
Can you imagine if all of a sudden it was only about your dollars pay for that or anything else? Here's the problem. Right now, the MTA is a monopoly. Monopolies are bad. Always.
Worked.
Monopolies are bad. They're never good. Just because you happen to slap a government on the side of it doesn't make the monopoly good. It's still bad. With the monopoly, you have no choice. If the MTA screws up, its punishment is give it more money.
Right.
That's its punishment. Here's more money. Right? If anyone else, if you mess up, your punishment is you're fired.
Right.
Right? Anyone else messes up, you're fired. The MTA messes up, more money. This is a broken system. It must be fixed from the root. I'm about real reform. not just let's raise more money and keep giving the same people the same garbage. We have to change the culture of this state away from one of punishment and bribery to one of opportunity and growth. We can do that if we change the culture.
So one of the things you just mentioned is a broken system, which leads me to family court. And I don't know how much information you have, but you told me everything is on the table.
Everything.
Any
questions?
I'm going to ask you, and I put on my Facebook page that I have Larry Sharpe coming on. Anybody post any questions that you want to ask? And the most popular one was, what can we do about the broken family court system in New York?
So there's the first several
parts. Let's talk about shared parenting and how do you feel about
the presumption
of shared
parenting? I don't want to fix the branch. I want to fix the root of family court. Now, there are several issues with family court, and many don't even know this. The first thing you want to fix family court, make lying in family court perjury.
Amen.
Number one thing.
Which is a joke now.
I can't believe that's not true.
No, it's totally
when I first heard that, I almost fell out of my chair. So you're in a court with a judge, and you can lie, and there's no
repercussions
whatsoever.
Perjury is
that
never
has prosecuted. To change immediately. You do that, many things will change. Number
you
one,
prosecute one or two, everybody's going to fall into line.
But it has to be perjury, because this way the lawyers are also responsible. Because lawyers right now, and you know this, are encouraging their people to lie because there is no repercussions for them or the client. In fact, they know they will get a better outcome if they lie.
It works.
They literally say, "Tell the judge that he beat you."
The
tell the judge
bullet,
cheated on
it.
You. Yes.
You get the order of protection, doesn't matter.
And order of protection now isn't criminal. You can get an order of protection via family court.
No jury.
Why is that? That is blatantly a break of our rights.
You got my vote.
Blatantly a break of our rights. So no, that has to end. With the treat, if you're in court, it's court. Number one, we do that, you will see a lot of things change. You will again see that there won't be as much lying. It won't be as vindictive. It won't be as angry, because how do you feel? You're the wife and you're feeling afraid that the husband's gonna walk away and take all the money. You're afraid. So what do you do when you're afraid? You get aggressive. And you're a lawyer who wants to get paid. You get aggressive. Now I get aggressive. Lawyer says, don't worry, lie about your husband. So she does. But not just her, her parents are also mad at you. So they lie also, because the lawyer tells them to lie. Doesn't say to lie, just goes, well, you know, if you say this, then this. The lawyer doesn't say lie. Right. If you say this, this will happen. Right. So now the whole family's lying. But of course, how do you feel? Well, you want to fight back. You lie too. So now everybody's lying on everybody. It's amazing, if you go to family court, everybody's cheating and beating their family.
Yep.
Yet I don't know anyone who's actually done that prior to getting
divorced. People married for 20 years.
Exactly.
No problem. All of a sudden they're in court and he beat me my whole life.
All of a sudden everyone's being beaten. Everyone's cheating.
They
all
need
of a sudden.
Order of protection.
That's correct. All of a sudden I'm afraid of them.
Yeah.
Exactly. That's how it happens every single time. So step one is that. But
there's
a second step. The second step is the priority right now is on money. The priority is on money. It must not be on money. The priority must be, how do I get this child to be with his or her kin? That must be the number one priority. Money matters, don't get me wrong. Money's important. But right now, money is the primary, which is why we take children and we take them away. And we don't even give them to, for example, say you are a bad guy and you beat your wife or whatever you do, but you're a bad guy. Okay, we won't give the kid to your mom. Because you might see them in some way, shape, or form, and that's a horrible thing. Here's what we know for sure to be a fact. The issue is a child is always statistically safer with kin than with strangers. Don't get me wrong, some kin are bad. Some strangers are bad. But statistically, we want to put the kid in the best possible chance for success, and that is being with kin. Now, I lost my father when I was 11. My father died. I wish I had my father in my life. If my father was a deadbeat dad, if he was, I'd rather have a deadbeat dad in my life than no dad. I would have taken that happily, eagerly. I would have taken it then, and I would take it now. So I want my father in my life. We have a huge rash of problems with relationship issues, right? Girls picking bad men, men going off to jail. You look at all those men in jail, the number one issue, where's your dad? Where's your dad?
It's something like over 80% of
it's insane.
Men in jail were raised without
where's
a father.
Where's their dad? Right. Nowhere. Because family court destroyed him, broke him. But here's the worst part about this. Not only is the man out of now the family, but the man himself is broken. There are many men, and I've been to father's rights events, and there are many men who are literally contemplating suicide.
And many do it.
And many actually kill themselves. They think the better answer is to off themselves. Now here's the worst part. You're a son. you are told by everybody around you, your father's a piece of garbage, your father's a piece of garbage. That is your image of manhood. How do you feel about yourself? We are destroying this entire generation of kids and not knowing why, and family law is an important piece. It must be, number one, about the child being with kin. Money, as important as it is secondary. But there's a third piece of this, and that is the judges in family law. As a general rule, judges in family law, these are people who are thinking of this as a way of just moving to the next layer. They don't want to be here. They hate family law. They don't want to be part of this. They think it's a punishment. They think they'd rather be in criminal or civil, whatever the case may be. I would argue family law is the most important court we have, because if we have a better family law, we will have less criminals. We will have less people with bad relationships. We'll have less people suing each other. Fix the family law. Fix the family, and all those other things get better. Family law should be priority. It should be important and valuable for judges. You fix these three things, the rest will fix themselves.
Larry, what about the presumption of shared parenting? Right now, as you know, the system is basically you go to court, the judge doesn't even have the option to give a true shared parenting. Yep. They call it just
and he doesn't want to.
They freak out. They want to make one person pay. The
correct.
State gets Title IV money.
Yep.
So there's incentive to do it. But there's, you know, instead of going in, we say it's the best interest of the children, which we all know is a bunch of crap.
That's a lie.
That's a joke.
That's a lie.
So what do you feel about, and I think this will solve a lot, but what's your opinion on the presumption of shared parenting?
No, I think that's the point, right? And I brought the idea of being with kin, right? Because I don't want to, because there are some bad parents. They do exist. Nowhere near what the court systems say. But there are some bad parents, so I don't want to force the judge to have to give it to a bad parent.
Right,
but I want the priority to be with kin, which that's assumed in my world.
Right.
In my world, shared parenting is the norm, and then if there is a proven bad parent, assuming, of course, lying is punishable by perjury, assuming that to be the case, there is a bad parent, there has to be actual evidence of a parent being a bad parent, then you still want to have the child be with the kin, right? Grandparents, uncle, cousin, etc., and the mom or dad.
Right.
So yes, I would mix those two together.
Okay, I just wanted to be clear because
yes.
People are going to be watching.
The
next thing is the Child Support Enforcement Unit. The amount that you have to pay
yep.
when you lose custody breaks people. It's got them living below
yes.
the poverty level,
100%.
And that makes them pissed off.
100%.
And then it puts them where they forces them into
yes.
arrears. And then what do? Now we take them to court and we take away their way to ever learn a living by putting them in jail.
We have
many judges here. Throw them in jail for 6 months.
Well, yes.
You know, take away his driver's license. Take away his professional license.
Yes.
Take away his passport. Garnish his pay.
Which makes so many fathers do one of two things. Literally, they go underground and
right.
do something illegal or off the books, or two, they abandon their families.
Right, because
these are two options they have. So again, this goes back, by the way, to my idea of making sure that this is all about number one priority is having the child with kin. If that's number one priority, and as governor, I will literally enforce that daily. This is important. What's important? Well, this guy couldn't pay. Great. How can you get this guy to be on a payment plan? But he owes $1 billion. Then forgive it. I want him with his son or daughter. I want the father with the son or daughter. But he should pay. I don't care about righteousness. I care about the actual benefit to the child, which is having kin in his or her
What's
life.
What's more important, having a parents or having money?
Having parents, without question.
Right.
That is demonstrably, clearly, and obviously a fact that no one can dispute. Would I rather have my father and say, no, I don't want my father because he doesn't give me enough money? Or I'd rather have my father and he can only buy me an ice cream and he can't take me out? Fine, buy me an ice cream, Dad. I want you in my life. 100% yes. This goes back to if you notice, I gave you three overall arching pieces that are the root. All those branches begin to fall the root is get the kid with kin.
Right.
If money gets in the way, money becomes secondary.
Right.
So maybe it's gonna forgive some debt and change what the dad is doing. And here's a general rule. Would the dad, in this case, could be mom, your dad, would the dad be responsible if they were still married? This is a very simple guideline I want you to think of. What does that mean? Let's say you can make $100,000 working. You can. If you get divorced, the judge will force you to make that.
You're imputed.
You have to do it.
You should be making it.
You need to. But what if you were married? Would you be forced to make $100,000 a year? No.
So why? What you love.
So why are you forced now?
Right.
But not just that. If I force you to something you hate, now your son has to watch you miserable. So I've hurt the child now. The son has to see you miserable. I've hurt the child. Money is hurting the child. Not neutral, it's hurting the child. Because now I see my father as a miserable old man. I don't want that. I want my father to be a positive, good role model for me, who's happy. That's what I want. So again, it goes back to the same concept.
So Larry, what do we do? We have a problem with bad judges here in New York, and occasionally they get arrested, but it's very rare. What do we do? Nobody wants to do anything. Politicians don't want to touch bad judges. We all know they're there. Some are corrupt, some are biased. What? And I know there's an impeachment process. Nobody does it.
No, it's called the Office of Transparency. That's what I want to create. I have several offices I want to create. One of them is the Office of Transparency. And that's the equivalent of like the Moreland Commission type style. That's that style, right? That idea of an ethics. It's the idea that we want things to be transparent. And I have a concept we can start already. I would like us to start literally, I'm making this up. This is very serious. This is very new concept. But I want us to rate judges. I want both sides to rate judges, and I want the judges to be publicly rated.
Right.
And if every single male says his judge sucks, and every single female says his judge is great, that's a biased judge.
That's a problem.
That's a biased judge. And I want to shame the judge and say, look at you, judge. What's wrong with you? You've got 100 cases, 99 men say you're horrible, 99 women say you're amazing. Guess what? You're a biased judge. What's wrong with you?
Right.
That's what I want to do. Literally, transparency. Transparency is the answer to corruption. When someone's corrupt, no one's thinking, well, am I going to get 5 years or 10 years? What's the punishment? No one's thinking that. They're thinking, will I be caught?
Right.
Will I get in trouble? The more transparent our system is, the less corruption there will be. That I'm sure of. If we make more transparency, there'll be less corruption. Can I end corruption? Of course not. No one can. If they say that, they're lying to you.
Right.
But we have a problem now. Our answer is arrest them and put them in jail. That's actually bad.
Why is that?
It's bad because of two things. One, if we have to keep arresting people and putting them in jail, it's not the people, it's the system. But if we arrest them, we tell, yes, look, we arrested this guy and put him in jail, aren't we awesome? No, because it fools us into believing we're fixing something. And we're not.
Clearly we're not, because
we're not fixing anything.
All the time.
That's
a
correct.
A new corrupt one comes
yes.
in.
Absolutely.
In Suffolk County, you see everybody's in jail.
100%. We're not fixing anything by putting them in jail. I'm not concerned as much about blame. I'm far more concerned about responsibility. And right now we have rule of no one. I'm a business consultant, as you've said. I always talk about this. If you're in charge of something, you're responsible. Not to be blamed, but someone's got to fix it. It's got to be you. All these MTA and Board of Regents and Economic Development Corporation, all this stuff that's kind of floating out there, all of that will be under me. I will be responsible. I will change that.
So I want to talk about corruption because we're leading into that. And that's, you know, I actually, when Cuomo ran, I supported him. And the main reason was because he said, I'm going to end corruption. I'm going to do a commission. I'm going to go after corruption. I said, oh, finally somebody's coming.
I'll forgive you.
He came in and he did the Moreland Commission. And I said, yes, he's doing what he said. And all of a sudden it got a little too close to home.
Yes.
He turned up. And he shut down the Moreland Commission.
Yep.
And yes, he didn't get arrested. Some other people got charged with
crimes. Remember, everyone else gets charged because what he does is he appoints the people, then they do the bad stuff. He's a very good capo.
Yeah,
he's a very good Don.
But
he
they
knows
shut it
how to
down,
get everyone
Larry.
Else arrested.
They shut it down.
Because they were actually going to get close to him.
Right. So
yes.
They shut it, and then everybody said, okay, it's done. He's not criminal. And then there's no more Moreland Commission.
That's correct.
But there was hundreds and hundreds of people who said, hey, I know about corruption.
Yes.
What will you, there's got to be a way, because for me it's frustrating as
I just said,
but I can't tell anybody about the corruption.
Two things. Number one, someone has to be responsible to stop the actual areas that are making us corrupt. All these boards, this is where it all happens. It all happens on all these boards, economic development corporations, MTA, Board of Regents. This is where all these things come from. And we funnel money through it, and people give their cronies money. But me, as the governor, I appoint my buddies, and they give me tons of money. But that's legal, so guess what? Everyone else goes to jail. We stop that and make things transparent, and things will change. That's the number one thing. When it becomes difficult and uncomfortable to be corrupt, less people will be corrupt. Right now, that's the way it's done. Yeah. It is comfortable to be corrupt. We have to break culture. Putting people in jail is fine, but it isn't the answer. Breaking the culture, and we can change this.
I have a lot of questions to ask. I'm right at 5 minutes, and the main thing I wanted to get was a family court, but one of my friends, Howard Nispel, posted on my Facebook, please ask him about the SAFE Act. And I, on its surface, thought both parties liked it. It was a great
thing. They do.
They love it. But then I heard tell me about the SAFE Act.
The Republicans and Democrats both passed it and both funded it. They love it. If you care about Second Amendment rights, the only candidate who cares is me. That's it. There is no one else. LarrySharpe.com, Larry Sharpe with an E, E stands for electable. Go to my website, you will see. I'm the only candidate who will do two things. Number one, I will immediately begin to pardon people who are victims of the SAFE Act. What the SAFE Act did is it made people who were legal gun owners, law-abiding citizens, all of a sudden, overnight, they were criminals because they have physically some equipment that the governor decides is now evil. That is wrong, immoral, and against our Second Amendment. That has to go. Those people will be pardoned. Second, I will immediately begin to talk about how I'm going to stop actually enforcing them. I make it the lowest possible priority, period. Lowest priority possible, and I will veto any funding. By 2019, everyone will see this is worthless. By 2020, it can be repealed. I will give the assembly the air cover it needs to repeal the SAFE Act. It is a problem. It should not exist. It's a bad idea. The reality of it is the Republicans and Democrats in this state are the same party. The Republicans have zero chance of winning this election in 2018 in a statewide election. Republicans are very good locally. They're viable and will win locally. Statewide, they cannot win. It is a wasted vote because not only will they not win, but nothing will change. The only person who can beat Cuomo is the guy you're looking at right now. That's it. It's Cuomo raising money, then me. I have raised more money than Republicans. They cannot win this thing. You want the SAFE Act repealed? You want corruption changed? You want the MTA fixed? You want family law courts fixed? I'm the guy who will do it. I've said it more than once. I am a fixer in my professional life. I'll do it for New York State.
So why should, because the big thing is the Democrats. So why should a Democrat, they're going to say, well, we like the SAFE Act. Why would we want to repeal it? Because we do have to do something about the gun violence. I don't know what it is. So why should a Democrat
vote
for Larry Sharpe?
And a hardcore Democrat is not going to vote for me. And I'm okay. A hardcore Republican is not going to vote for me. I'm okay with that. They're going to go back. I don't need all the votes. I need enough votes to win, which is a lot of people who are unhappy Democrats and unhappy Republicans. If you're happy with the Republican Party, you're going to vote Republican. Okay, good luck. You're wasting your time, but fine. You're happy with the Democratic Party. Good luck. You're going to vote for them. You think Cuomo is doing a good job as 100,000 New Yorkers leave every year. Fine, good luck. But there are a lot of people who realize the Republican Party is broken and the Democratic Party is corrupt. If you realize that, that's my voter. But more importantly, there are 8 million New Yorkers who aren't going to vote this year. I just need 10% of them, and I'm the governor.
That's it.
10% of them. That's all I need.
To register to vote. But what are you going to do about the gun violence? Because people are going to watch both parties. They're afraid about sending their kids to school.
Yep.
Tell me what your issue is with the SAFE Act, because I was watching some videos about the the mandating reporting, and there's some unintended consequences.
There's tons of them. What it actually does is it forces people to report on their neighbors. But not just that. You have people who actually have problems, issues, concerns, and they're not going to say it because they're going to lose their firearms now. You have veterans coming back from wars with PTSD who don't want to say they have PTSD, who don't want to have help because they lose their Second Amendment rights. You have people, this is a true story, literally, you get in a car accident, and now you're going to the emergency room. You're in pain, and you say things like, I'm in so much pain, I want to die. The doctors report you as suicidal. I'm not joking. If you're on medical marijuana, you lose your Second Amendment rights. This is embarrassingly bad. Why in the world should this happen? It's wrong. You want to actually make kids safer in school? Reform school. School's the problem. You have a whole bunch of unhappy kids. Well, it's about guns. Okay, how many guns were used in the Boston bombing? How many guns were used in 9/11? None. How many guns were used in Oklahoma? None. How many guns used that guy who killed those people with the van in Manhattan? 8. None. Tons of people use other weapons. There are more murders right now in London than there are in New York City. Why? Knives. Are we going to ban knives now?
Right. Well, I think it goes back to the family law reform, too.
Thank you.
That's the problem.
You want to make kids don't want to kill each other? Here's what they say. They go, wait a minute, Larry. I don't want kids to use guns when they kill their fellow students. What weapon would you choose? A Vanguard? You happy with that? Happy with a knife? Bomb? A pressure cooker? What are you happy with? How about this? I'm happy with none of them. I want kids to not want to kill their fellow students. That means happier kids, that means better schools, that means better families. That we can work on.
Right. Larry Sharpe, thank you very much. Tell people where to reach you again. We'll put it on
Larry Sharpe for New York Facebook page or LarrySharpe.com.
But if you didn't get anything else, you're not throwing away your vote. Send a message, and Larry does have a chance to win. As he said, if he gets 10%, of the people who didn't vote, he is the governor.
That's correct.
It's time for a change. It's not working the way it is. We'll see you next week.
Long Island Backstory is made possible in part by Americans for Legal Reform, the oldest, most successful legal group in the world,